So the definition is shown here. We're not going to belabor this. ERS, ATS got together in 14 and said, hey, how about we harmonize our definition for severe asthma? And as you can imagine, it's uncontrolled asthma despite maximum therapy, high-dose ICS, LABA, another controller, plus or minus systemic steroids. Makes sense. The GINA guidelines, which I think is a little crisper than the old NAEP guidelines, which is dated but is being revised, we know that GINA 4-5 is where we're going to position monoclonal antibodies. These are patients who are, despite high-dose ICS LABA, require typically an antimuscarinic and are refractory to current therapy. It's in that space that we're thinking about the use of monoclonal antibodies, and rightly so. Now, there are many aspects that contribute to the refractory patient, and I'm definitely preaching to the choir here. You as practitioners of the art, as specialists as I, we see the comorbidity over and over and over again. Need to treat the nose and the sinuses to control the asthma, but we can't forget about smoking as a contributor to refractory asthma. About 30%, 28% of patients with asthma smoke, obstructive sleep apnea, and reflux, very common comorbidities. Other contributing factors, as we know, adherence is a struggle and an obstacle and a challenge. Also, inhaler technique and environmental trigger remediation. All told, the deck is stacked against us to treat refractory asthma. We have adherence issues for patients, inhalers that are problematic, so we look for other therapies, therapies that are going to be parenteral in nature. Now, how do we differentiate severe from uncontrolled asthma? Severe asthma is lots of medicines, but not in the ER, not in the hospital, and not requiring oral corticosteroids. Watch the patient's inhaler technique, identify adherence and barriers, confirm the diagnosis. You are well aware that all that wheezes is not asthma. If possible, remove risk factors, consider treatment step up, and then may refer to a specialist or severe asthma clinic. And there, I think what that offers is therapies like bronchial thermoplasty or other therapies for some patients.
So obviously, uncontrolled versus severe is not usually the is a dilemma out there for clinical for clinicians, and setting the stage very nicely as Ray did. How we differentiate uncontrolled from severe is very important, because while 50 to 60% of asthmatics there are uncontrolled, only about 5 to 10% of asthma patients have severe asthma. Right now, our definition is based on the utilization or need of high-dose steroids plus a LABA or other controllers. Once the checklist that Ray showed is done, the comorbidities, the triggers, the compliance, the adherence, everything, inhaler technique. Why are we concerned about severe asthma? Obviously, the morbidity associated with this. Many of these patients, as you see on this slide, have frequent symptoms, exacerbations. That is tied in with persistent loss of function, lung function decline, impairment, poor quality of life. And many of these patients have comorbidities. While we are lung doctors, we focus on the lung, but indeed, we have to look at the whole patients. In fact, many of them have significant upper airway symptoms. Many of these late onset severe asthma patients have rhinosinusitis, polyposis. Others have other things. And this leads to other comorbidities. It's the chicken or the egg. Is it anxiety and depression are listed here. I have some interest in these comorbidities. And I really want you all to think, because it's a two-way highway here, because anxiety can actually worsen asthma, but at the same time, uncontrolled severe asthma can lead to this too. So what have we known, and why is it that 5 to 10% of patients, no matter what you do, they're still having symptoms? Well, that really led us to start thinking outside the box. It's not a one-size-fits-all disease. We now know that there are multiple phenotypes for asthma. And many of the factors shown on this slide can contribute to these phenotypes. There is definitely a genetic link, you know, and there are environmental links. There is a lung function, you know, the decline lung function over time, even since childhood may contribute to this. And of course, the patient. What do we know about phenotypes? Well, phenotypes really are a clinical sort of description of how patients present to us. They may not be as helpful as what we call endotypes, which are more helpful in defining targeted therapies because they really reflect mechanisms. So phenotypes are more the clinical presentation of patients. And we use the onset of the disease, either early onset or late onset. We also look at biomarkers like eosinophils or allergies to define it. Some of the phenotypes, and these are not inclusive of all what we know, are listed on this slide. Early onset allergic asthma tends to be very common. That's the classic asthma we're used to from even medical school. Patients start having asthma early on in life, has allergy triggered, has signs of that by the skin testing or blood testing. But the late onset eosinophilic and late onset asthma is another phenotype. These patients may not be driven by allergens. In fact, many of them don't have an allergy triggered asthma. They may have other triggers, but they may present with eosinophilia, also signs of T2 inflammation on biomarkers, which we'll talk about. There are also late onset asthmatics who are non-atopic. Many of them are obese, particularly in women. These patients may have minimal airway inflammation, but quite a significant airway obstruction. And then there are the frequent exacerbators. Actually, as it is in COPD, one of the biggest predictor of exacerbation is past history of exacerbation. So those are those who keep getting oral steroid courses, ER visits. And then, of course, there's another primary in women, the late onset obese asthma.